Well, good morning. I hope your Sunday is off to a great start. You know, health care is a major topic of concern as senators and representatives in Washington debate what role the government will play in determining future policies in this country. Today, we're going to talk about that and more with someone who must deal with those issues each day. It starts right now.
From TV6, this is the Ryan Report. Now, here's your host, Don Ryan.
Well, our guest today is Dennis Smith, who is the president and CEO of the Upper Peninsula Health Plan. This morning, we'll learn more about Dennis, his organization, and the challenges currently facing the healthcare industry. Dennis, welcome to the Ryan Report.
Well, thank you. Thanks, Donna. Thanks for having me here.
First of all, let's make sure people understand what your company is. You know, we have UP Health Systems, which is the former Marquette General. We have UP Home Health and Hospice. Neither of those companies are yours.
Right.
You're the UP Health Plan. Tell us, what role does your company play?
Our role, really, we have contracts with the state of Michigan and the federal government to provide health benefits for certain populations. So we have Medicaid, we have the Medicaid expansion population, we have children's special health care needs, which are specific for kids that have long-term issues, and then we have Medicare and Medicare Advantage, and then we have what's called the My Health Link, which is the new pilot program we're doing with the federal government and the state of Michigan for people that have both Medicaid and Medicare needs.
Okay. How about you? I was looking at a little bit of your history. I think you grew up in the Ann Arbor area?
Yep. Whitmore Lake, which is about 8 miles north of Ann Arbor. And so that was way back before US 23 went through, and it was still two-lane roads back through there. And then I went to high school in Ann Arbor. There was a little high school on the campus of U of M called University High School.
Okay.
That was developed back in the 20s, basically as an outlet for student teachers.
Okay. So there was something similar at Northern.
Right, exactly.
State, right.
And so I think that as that went through, and then I graduated, went on to Eastern, and then took some courses at Western, and so I've been bouncing around. But I've been in healthcare since 1971.
Did you always have healthcare as a kind of a goal when you started?
No, I think when I got out, I was in education, and so I was going to be a teacher, and a history teacher, and so in college, I was a history major with literature and language minor. You know, I got the phone call from my counselor in my second semester of my junior year and said, you haven't declared a minor, and so that's what we put together. But when I came out in 71, they'd been pushing this whole retirement thing from the mid-60s on for teachers, and so when I came out, everything was full.
Okay.
And so I'd worked at the hospital in the evenings full-time for a couple of years to put myself through school. And so they opened up this unit management program, which was kind of like a business manager for the nursing floors and an ombudsman for the patients. And so that's how I got into healthcare.
And imagine if you had gone down that history teacher track, things would be very different.
Very different.
How did you wind up in Marquette?
Well, it was interesting. I worked for 15 years. When I left the hospitals, I went to work for the Hospital Association in their service corporation. And so I headed up their insurance agency and their pension services. And so most of these hospitals were clients of mine in some fashion or another. So consequently, when they had an opening, I got a couple different calls, and so we were just kind of wondering whether we wanted to come to Marquette from Grand Rapids, where we were living then. And I came up again, and we interviewed, and it just kind of worked out. And all the people that I interviewed with and that I first started with in 03, we just hit it off, and it was a great opportunity for me personally.
And I think you've come to enjoy the UP lifestyle?
Yes, I have.
Let's talk back about your company. It was organized, I think, in 1998, perhaps, originally?
98 was the kickoff, August 1 of 1998. The forerunner to that was really 95,
okay,
when they started to do the healthcare, the Upper Peninsula Healthcare Network, which was a member-driven shared services company. So they got grants for telehealth. They got grants for the mobile MRIs, which are still running around. They got grants for several services that the smaller hospitals up here couldn't afford individually back then, but they could do collectively.
Okay.
That then spun off the Upper Peninsula Managed Care Company, which was really a 50-50 relationship between the physicians and the hospitals, and that kind of morphed then when the state decided to go into managed care for Medicaid in 97. They put out a bid, UPHP was formed, they submitted the bid, they got the bid. And so that's why they started August 1 of 1998 with, I think, about three people. That by the time the end of that first day, they had six employees.
And that was kind of when that whole managed care idea was kind of getting off the ground?
Yep.
And not just applying to Medicaid and those, but also to private insurance?
Private insurance all across the board. And the issue that the hospitals and the physicians here were concerned about with being small, separate little groups, they wouldn't be able to bargain effectively on discounts, and they all could get, you know, harmed financially significantly. So they kind of got together their physician hospital organization, which is part of the managed care company. So we really kind of do a lot of the negotiation with the various companies, whether it's Humana, whether it's Cigna, whether it's Aetna, to kind of get some structure into how that's set up.
You say they started with maybe 6 employees. How many employees do you have today?
I think last check last week was 145, and we're four options now. We've got 4 slots we're going to fill. It's going to be pretty close to 150, I think, by the end of the year.
You're a major employer and major industry in Marquette.
Yes, we are.
And you have a nice new office building as well.
Yes, we're very pleased with our office building. It's serving us very, very well.
Okay. Responsibilities have changed a lot over the years, haven't they?
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk more about that, but we have to take a break.
Okay.
We'll be back with more on the Ryan Report in just 2 minutes. Once again, our guest this morning is Dennis Smith. Dennis is the CEO of UP Health Plan. Dennis, you're the only company that does what you do in the Upper Peninsula?
Yes. In 2002, UPHB wasn't doing very well financially. There was another company here that wasn't doing very well financially. It was from downstate. And so I think what they realized, the state and the feds and UPHB and the board, is that they needed to get a bigger pool of individuals to kind of spread the risk. And so in 2002, then, the federal government, the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare, put through a rule exception for UPHB to be the only HMO dealing with Medicaid and Medicare, or Medicaid specifically, in the Upper Peninsula. So that let us grow then to about 24,000 folks, and then that grew to 27,000 folks. And now we manage over 50,000 individuals through Medicaid and the various programs, populations we have as far as, and Medicare.
There are other companies in the state, though, aren't there? I think I saw where there were maybe 8 or 10 companies that do this in Michigan.
There's 14 other health plans, or 13 other health plans. We're one of 14, and there are various groupings do various things. We have some that only do the MyHealthLink, which is that dual. There's like 4, I think, that do that, but there's about 14 that do Medicaid, and Medicaid specifically with contracts with the state. So.
And you're limited to the UP as far as the territory you serve?
Yes.
Okay. You had mentioned to me there was a conference. I know you're interested in more than just insurance.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, you're part of the whole healthcare picture. And there's a major conference going on this weekend. Tell us about that.
That's the UP Healthcare Solutions Trustees Forum, and it's been going on probably for 25, almost 30 years. And so one weekend in April, on Friday night, they'll have all the trustees from around the UP are invited. And then we have guest speakers on pertinent topics that they'll need to know about for the next year or two. Because being rural, we have a harder time getting some of the information out. So we have an individual coming in from Washington, D.C. that's going to speak specifically on healthcare reform after the ACA. And obviously that's been adjusted a little bit in the last 2 weeks. But,
right.
You know, I just looked at his presentation this morning. It's pretty spot on. And then we have some presentations with the Hospital Association. We'll do some updating because they're all hospital trustees. And then we have a legislative panel that evening, which we have most of the UP legislative folks are going to be gracious with their presence and kind of do some discussion. Saturday is a key thing on, it's called the Highly Reliable Organizations certifications that these hospitals can get. They really focus on quality, readmissions, infections, expansion of services, social determinants, things like that, to affect so that the community hospital really is focused as a major asset in the community and all the things that it can do to help you as an individual of a consumer of healthcare in your community.
And this can really affect people in our community.
Yes.
Very much so. You know, let's talk a little bit about what's going on in Washington, and not to be political,
mm-hmm.
You know, because that's not our job here today, but maybe to help people understand what's going on. And, you know, talking about your conference, this has to be a very difficult time to be a hospital administrator with all the uncertainty out there.
It's very tough. I think that last week there was an article in Crain's, Rod Nelson was highlighted from Mackinac Straits, in which they were talking about how the other proposal that didn't quite go forward, how that would have negatively affected hospitals. And I think, you know, 11 of our 15 hospitals in the UP are what we call critical access hospitals. They're 25 beds or smaller. They have restricted services. They get a little extra compensation, but, you know, they're small. And so their margin of profitability or even net income is very, very small. I mean, 1% would be great for some of them. And so with Medicaid expansion over the last several years, it's really at least stabilized that in that it's reduced the amount of bad, out-of-pocket bad debt, things like that. So that's, I think, it's really difficult. So I don't care where you are, if you're at Helen Newberry Joy, or if you're at Barraga, or you're at Aspirus Ironwood, they're all very thin margins to operate on. And so when you, even when you look at things like UP Health System Marquette or Dickinson Community Health System or WAR, they're larger, but they still have a big overhead burden. And so I think those are very tough things to do. And with all the constant change that, that kind of goes in, it's hard to lay out a 3 to 5 year financial picture because you're always changing it.
You know, it's even nonprofit hospitals have to make a profit. They have,
right.
You know, have to run in the black by the end of the year to pay everything they have to do. Let's talk about some of the things we hear. Okay, from one side we hear that the present system is going to implode. There's some real danger, and there are insurance companies that are walking away, aren't there?
Right. I think that there are some structures within the current system that make it a little bit erroneous or erroneous, burdensome for health insurance companies. Because you have to cover things that maybe actuarially aren't rates for, like kids up to 26. That's been great, though, for families. That's been great for everybody else. It's helped spread that risk, but still, it's tough. There are a lot of regulations that have kind of walked through that really increase the overhead cost. So when you're talking about insurance companies and this, that, or whatever, they can pay about 85 to 90% of their premiums into medical expenses. So they pay for the hospital or the doctor or the drugs or whatever. The other part is really their overhead, and that's really where if they're going to make anything to roll forward, it's going to be in the administrative cost. The ACA is pretty burdensome with a lot of regulations in that. Some have been very good for us in insurance companies, quite frankly, but then some are just, you know, extra layers of people that we have to do, extra reporting that we have to do, and it becomes really kind of an administrative nightmare. So those are the things. When people talk about insurance companies imploding or getting off the exchanges, it's because that you have really kind of very little leverage to go around things.
And on the other side, they say the Republican proposal would, 18 million people is one number I've heard would, you know, could lose their coverage.
Well, I think 18 million, I've heard 8 million, I've heard 14 million. The vast majority, when you talk to some people though, on either side of the aisle, will agree that a lot of that will be voluntary. There'll be young folks that are healthy and didn't have it before, don't want it now. You know, if there's not going to be a penalty on their taxes. But there will be still a solid segment that will be in that no man's zone, so to speak. If you look at the Medicaid expansion in Michigan with Healthy Michigan Plan, there's like 650,000 people that now have some sort of coverage. So when they approach their physician or they go to the hospital for something, they have some sort of coverage. Those are really the people that are at risk, I think, because if that program goes away, then you'll have 650,000 people without coverage that will wait till the last second to go to an ED, which then is even more expensive because whatever condition they had is now a lot worse than it was before.
Okay. We have to take one more break. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes after this commercial break. Once again, we're talking to Dennis Smith this morning. Dennis is the CEO of UP Health Plan. We were talking about Medicaid before the break, and really, Michigan has one of the better Medicaid plans, I believe.
It does. It was a struggle to get through, but the concept was they wanted to make sure that there was consistency in what we were doing. It went from 100% federal poverty level to 133%, so people in there. So they have some co-pays and deductibles, so they have some responsibility. The concern, I think, at the legislator's point was if we don't give them some responsibility and make some of that their responsibility to do things, then we're just throwing stuff away. And so I think they've been surprised at how many people got on. There's about 25 to 30% of the population right now does a health risk assessment, which is kind of mandatory. So it's been very, I think, a great surprise. They were projecting 400,000 people. Like I said, they got 650,000. It's a little bit under scrutiny now because next April of 2018, it will be at the end of its 4 years.
Okay.
So the way the legislature was written, if you don't do certain things in that four-year period, then you bounce out. Okay. So now we're into kind of like a little mushy no man's place because the state of Michigan needs to have a specific product on the exchange for these people to go to. The federal government, they still look at this as a Medicaid benefit. So it's kind of like, how are you going to do that? And so you need a lot of folks to kind of do a new product to go on the exchange. And so we have about 3,500 people that we still got to catch up to out of our 16,000 that are in this.
Okay.
So if we get enough done, then we probably won't do that, and they'll just kind of flow over to whatever the state's going to do.
And this is one of the areas that could also be endangered if things change in Washington.
Significantly, because a lot of the money supporting the program, as all Medicaid dollars, comes from the federal government. So they're like overfunding this a little bit, you could say, so that in 2015, the cost was like $20 per member per month for the state, with everything they get and everything else. Well, by the end of 18, I think it's going to be up to $81, and then it will go to 117. Then, kind of, and in 2020, the state is 100% on their own. So the concern in Lansing is that if this doesn't expand and keep going, then there will be a significant financial responsibility on the state of Michigan. Now, the theory was when they started it, Governor Snyder's principles were the money that we're going to save, we're going to put aside for a rainy day fund to help supplement that. So I still think that's part of their goal. But the issue really will be if it goes away, if the funding cuts and we go to block grants out of Washington, that could significantly impact Medicaid expansion at several states across the United States.
Okay. We have only a minute left. What should we be hoping for? What would we like to see happen in Washington?
Well, I think in public policy, what we want to really see is that if the states are going to be responsible, either through a block grant or through other mechanisms, they have the autonomy to do their own direction. That's what the governor's been pushing for. That's what many of the legislature are pushing for. The worst of all cases is that you get this program mandated by Washington and you have no flexibility. Every region of the state of Michigan is different. Every state in the United States is different. And so we need some sort of flexibility with some benchmark goals that you need to do. But that, okay, if you're in the UP, we have a little bit older population, we need more services here. If you're in Wayne County, you might have more homeless, and so you do different services there. If you're in West Michigan, same thing, they may be healthier, and so you can tailor those. That's what we really want from the federal government.
We have only 30 seconds left. From all the organizations you deal with, is there any opportunity for compromise here to move ahead?
I think there is. I think that once everybody sits down and all the rhetoric stops, there are some commonalities. Everybody wants to take care of the individual. Everybody wants it to be fiscally funded. Everybody wants stability. And I think it's really what building blocks are you going to do? What are you going to change in the current program to do that?
Okay, we've probably barely scratched the surface, but thanks for coming in this morning to talk to us.
Thank you. I enjoyed it very much.
Appreciate it very much, Dennis. Okay, I'll be back with some other thoughts for you after we take this break. Well, partly because of our discussion earlier, today we examine the word compromise. The dictionary defines compromise as an agreement or a settlement of a dispute that's reached by each side making concessions. Comedian Henny Youngman had an old joke about the subject. Henny said, "My wife wanted a fur coat, but I wanted a new car, so we compromised. We bought a fur coat, but we keep it in the garage." But on a more serious note, it seems the people who represent us in Washington no longer accept the idea of compromise, even though their unwillingness to work together works against the best interests of the people they represent. The current healthcare debate seems to provide a pretty good example. I've been around for a while and had the chance to observe the activities in Washington for a long time. We've always had partisan politics going back far beyond the days that I can remember. It's not a bad thing. It gets different views on the table. But there was a time in this country when leaders from both sides would eventually come together and work together to develop compromise solutions that would benefit most, if not all, the people who live here. In recent years, it seems we just can't do that anymore. There are times when compromise isn't possible. Some issues are pretty much black and white, and you must choose a side and stand on principle. But many of the issues our representatives deal with aren't that cut and dried. Former Republican President General Dwight Eisenhower said, "People talk about the middle of the road as though it were unacceptable. Actually, all human problems, excepting morals, come into the gray areas. Things are not all black and white. There have to be compromises. The middle of the road is all the usable surface. The extremes, right and left, are in the gutters." The words of General Dwight Eisenhower. Former Democratic President Lyndon Johnson said, "I'm a compromiser and a maneuverer. I try to get something. That's the way our system works." Former President John F. Kennedy said, "Let us never negotiate out of fear, but let us never fear to negotiate." And someone once said, "A compromise is an agreement whereby both parties get what neither of them wanted." We don't take political sides on this show. We love them all equally. And we try to give them all a chance to let us know why they make the decisions they do. But we would love to see them work together to solve the problems that affect all of us. And while I'm quoting thoughts of others, let me close with this one from Jack Handy, not a politician, but an American humorist, best known for his Deep Thoughts by Jack Handy. It has nothing to do with our discussion today, but I just like it. He said, "Before you criticize someone, you should walk a mile in their shoes. That way, when you criticize them, you're a mile away and you have their shoes." I'll be back in a minute. Just about time to wrap it up for another week. The Today Show is ready to move in and keep the information flowing. Keep in mind that if you miss it, you can also watch this show on the internet. Just go to UpperMichiganSource.com, where you'll also find the latest news 24 hours a day. Thanks to Dennis Smith for joining us this morning. The healthcare debate is still raging, and it was good to get some insights into those issues from someone who works with them every day. And thank you for joining us. Hope you enjoy the rest of your day, and we'll join us again next Sunday morning.